So, good morning. This is October 23rd, 2020. Letters Boltzmann lecture number one. Okay, I see that at least five of you are here in Braunschweig. The others didn't answer. This lecture is streamed on YouTube, so if you have any problems seeing me on big blue button, you can use the link that is in the shared in the shared notes and see the lecture on YouTube. Okay, it's also 9:45, so time to start. So if you have any comments, please write them in the chat. And if you turn on your microphone and say anything, then please remember we are streamed on YouTube, so everybody can hear what you say. Yeah, so don't say embarrassing things. Another thing is that I have introduced this Rocket Chat Messenger. The link is also in the shared notes. This is what we are going to use to communicate offline, out of the time of the lecture. So this lecture series is on the Lattice-Boltzmann method. And the Lattice-Boltzmann method is a numerical tool for fluid mechanics, and it comes from the kinetic theory of gases. It is derived from the kinetic theory of gases, so it comes from actually the Boltzmann equation. Today we have an introductory lecture where we don't talk about the Lattice-Boltzmann, but we talk about the Boltzmann equation so that you learn where everything is coming from. Actually, you can be very successful using the Lattice-Boltzmann method even. You can be very successful using the Lattice-Boltzmann method even if you don't understand kinetic theory. But if you want to know what people are talking about when they talk about kinetic theory, it is better to know where everything is coming from. Yeah. So today is a little bit more philosophical than many of the lectures later. So, okay, lecture one, Boltzmann equation. The content of today's lecture is the atomistic versus the continuous versus the macroscopic worldview, if you like. Then, of course, we go to the Boltzmann equation, not the Lattice-Boltzmann equation, but the Boltzmann equation, the original equation. We talk about the collision integral, conserved quantities, and the so-called eta theorem, yeah? Or sometimes also called H theorem. Okay, we start with these three ways to describe the world. Yeah, the first one is, let me see if I have the right pen. So this is the atomistic. Or as you may also say, the molecular. Worldview, where we describe the physics just by using Newton. Yeah, so Newton means we have a mass times an acceleration of, say, any particle, yeah, in a system of many particles is the sum of all the forces that act on the particle. So in this worldview, we talk about molecules or particles, yeah, molecules. And molecules, and this is the important thing here, they are distinct. So you can distinguish between all the molecules. You know all the molecules by name. molecules or particles, more general. And they simply obey Newton's law. So this is a way we can describe the world. Yeah. So we have molecules. There are forces between molecules, laws of motion. And they, of course, exchange energy and momentum. By these forces. And these forces are usually binary forces. So there are two particles that exchange momentum and energy. So, and there are, of course, many particles, but each of them is a pair. So when they exchange momentum, they have a pair with a, they pair up with another particle. So there may be many particles, yeah. But each interaction can be described as an interaction between two particles, yeah. Of course, each of them with each of them. Okay, so this is pretty straightforward. The next way to describe the world is the continuous description. Continuous, and now I have to write this correctly. So, the continuous description, and well, if we think about freely moving particles, such like in a fluid or in a gas or in a liquid, where particles can freely move, then the continuous description of this would come from the Navier-Stokes equation. The Navier-Stokes equation can be written down in different forms. I give you a simple form. So in order not to write too much, I write the differential operator for the time as simply partial t. So there is the change of a velocity u in time, yeah, plus so-called advection term is equal to a gradient of pressure, which we have to normalize by the density, plus a diffusion term coming with viscosity constant nu. This is kinematic viscosity, and here Laplace u. Okay, so this together is a material derivative. Okay, so this is the Navier-Stokes equation. And this describes any flowing matter. So flowing matter, we are mostly talking about gases, and we can also use this for liquids. So flowing matter is a continuous field obeying conservation laws, the conservation of momentum and energy. And of course, mass. Actually, the Navier-Stokes equation itself, as it is written here. Okay, we need one more equation here. Sorry, we also need a continuity equation. So this here is the continuity equation describing the continuity of matter. And okay, the energy equation is not explicitly written here, but this would usually be included. So conserved momentum, angular momentum, and in this form, it does not conserve energy, but we can write another equation and then it would also conserve energy. And what it conserves is, okay, it also conserves mass, of course. So which one is right? Which of the two is correct? So this Navier-Stokes equation is a child of the 19th century, yeah, a time when people were thinking that there is no such thing as atoms. And this is an interesting historical. Okay, so you have a question. Okay, somebody. If you write a question, please write it in the okay, yeah. So one of the reasons why I'm using YouTube is that in the first semester that we had these home lectures, we realized that Big Blue Button has very choppy sound. So if you have problems with the sound, I guess that you have to switch to YouTube. Yeah, this is the reason why I have to, why I introduced this thing. Okay? Okay, I hope you can deal with this on YouTube. I can't do anything other than, you know, streaming on YouTube. So people are typing. Okay, maybe you use the lecture is recorded on YouTube. Oh, the lecture, yeah, we are recording on YouTube, so you can see it on YouTube later. Is this okay? I could also record it on Big Blue Button. I forgot to start it on Big Blue Button, but it will be recorded on YouTube. Please watch it on YouTube later. Okay, so an historical note, yeah. The ancient Greek people, so 3,000 years ago. They believed in atoms. And I think that probably in history or in recent history, it would have been easier for scientists to believe in atoms if ancient Greek people didn't. Because that it's surprisingly reasoned that the atomistic view of matter is actually accepted by scholars nowadays. So I want to give you two citations. Yeah, let me see whether this works with this tool. No, it doesn't. Where's my cursor? So I want to give you two. Two citations, yeah. So I don't want to imply anything by citing Nietzsche. This is just that Nietzsche was, of course, somebody who was, yeah, I mean, up to his time, yeah. Nietzsche in 1886, Beyond Good and Evil, said about the atomistic view of the world, as far materialistic atomism goes, this is one of the most well-refuted in existence. In Europe these days, nobody in the scholarly community is likely to be so unscholarly as to add real significance to it. So this means like 130 years ago, if you believed in atoms, you did something extremely, extremely stupid from the point of view of some scientists. From a philosophical point of view. So, of course, Nietzsche was a philosopher, not a scientist. So, then we have a scientist. I can also cite a scientist if you believe in this. This actually comes a little later. So, you probably know Ernst Mach, or I hope that you heard about Ernst Mach. Oops. This was not correct. Why didn't it work? Okay. See, this tool is stupid. How do I get this larger? Okay, you know what? I write it by hand. Seems to be the only option here. So it's in German. It's so some of you can exercise a bit. Yeah. So Ernst Mach. So Ernst Mach is of course the guy with the Mach number. Yeah, and he lived, I think, to something like 1910. Something that he said after 95. So it's in German. It's an exercise for some of you. It's actually a little bit difficult German. So ich muss es aber nun mit derselben Entschiedenheit ablehnen, den Relativisten, das ist of course, Einstein. Vorangestellt zu werden. Mit welcher ich die atomistische Glaubenslehre der heutigen Schule oder Kirche Okay, so he says this is a church, yeah. So what Ernst Mach said in 1905 is that relativism, so the theory of relativity, is as wrong as the idea of the existence of atoms. Yeah? So Ernst Mach was one of the most famous physicians in the late 19th century. So this is a reason not to listen too much to old professors. So they say this is not a good idea. And here you see what is the... So actually, the Navier-Stokes equation, yeah, is in a sense older than the atomistic view of matter, as long as you don't count the Greek atomistic view. So now we have something in between, and this is the thing that this lecture is going to be about. This is the mesoscopic view. So mesoscopic. And the mesoscopic view is governed by what we now call the Boltzmann equation. So Boltzmann and Mach were on the same university in Vienna. And Boltzmann had to suffer a lot under Mach. Actually, Boltzmann committed suicide. It's not completely sure whether he committed suicide because he was mistreated by Mach that much, but it is known that he was mistreated by Mach. Okay, so the Boltzmann equation looks like this. We have the change in time, f, of a so-called distribution function, f. The distribution function is statistical function that gives the probability of finding a particle in a certain state. And now we have actually a sort of material derivative, which is similar to the one that we have in the Navier-Stokes equation, but just a little bit different. So this here is a xi. Xi is a microscopic velocity, scalar product with nabla. And there's another term that we are not talking too much about today. This is a forcing term. So F is the force, M is the mass of one particle. And here, this is a differential operator in velocity space. Yeah, so we're not going too much into detail on this, and this is equal on the other side to so-called collision operator. Okay, so we'll have a look to all of this in detail just in a minute. So what is now the difference between this and the other views? So now we also have molecules, so we believe in molecules now. So Boltzmann believed in molecules at a time when this was not normal to believe in molecules. I actually prefer to write on the blackboard and not on this here. Molecules are now undistinguishable. Should write this capital. So they are undistinguishable particles. And they are also following Newton's laws. So what is now the difference between the atomistic view and this mesoscopic view? In the atomistic view, we distinguish between each molecule. So we know each molecule by name. Yeah? Each molecule is an entity in itself. And here in the Boltzmann equation, we also deal with molecules, but we say that these molecules, at least if they are of the same kind, we say they are all the same. Right? So we do not distinguish between this is molecule number one and this is molecule number two. We just have an ensemble of molecules. Yeah, and this ensemble of molecules, this behaves somehow. And by doing this, we have already forgotten almost everything. So now this is the link to the atomistic view, but there's also a link to the continuous view because the Boltzmann equation actually is a continuous view of matter. So I should write the F the same way as I write it, as I wrote it before. So F, what is F? F is the probability of finding a particle in this seven-dimensional phase space . So seven-dimensional, what does it mean? So seven-dimensional, there are three dimensions of location. Right, so there's x, y, and z. Yeah, so you can be somewhere in space, and this particle has velocity. This velocity we describe by the vector small xi, which has the components xi, so this here is supposed to be an ypsilon, crack ypsilon, and zeta. So these are the three components of the velocity, and at time t. So these are the seven dimensions of the distribution, yeah. So we can locate it in space, we can locate it in velocity, and we can locate it in time. Okay, so a lot of dimensions. So because this is a probability, it's actually continuous, yeah. So it's or is potentially continuous. It's not necessarily continuous, but it's potentially continuous, and in such, it's again bridges the gap between between the atomistic view and the continuous view that we see in the Navier-Stokes equation. And this can be done more general, but this we'll see later. It's a bit too much for today. So, okay, we'll have to do some notes. Right, so note the mesoscopic view. So mesoscopic means somewhere in between, so it's neither large nor small, so it's in between. Bridges. So if I don't write everything correct, I'm a bit dyslexic, yeah, so please correct it yourself. So it bridges the atomistic and continuous views. And it uses statistics of particles instead of actual particles, or instead of individual particles. So, and then there is something that you will often read and hear, and I, in my opinion, will tell you that this is a misconception, and this is why I pointed out here directly. It is a misconception that the validity of these models have anything to do with size. So you can describe basically everything with each model. There are, of course, exceptions, but these when things don't, yeah, when one model doesn't work or the other model works better, but they are not necessarily linked to size. But for this, we would have to wait for another lecture. So we don't apply the Boltzmann equation to a size that is in between molecular dynamics and fluid dynamics. This is not correct. So, but I expect that there are people out in the outside world that disagree with my statement here. Okay. So then have a closer look at the Boltzmann equation. Okay, let's write it again so that we see the different terms. So, no. So, okay, we have the time derivative. We have, so this is here. Change with time, obviously. Then we have this guy. This guy is an advection operator. Then we have a force operator. And this operator here is usually used for long range forces. Such as gravity or electromagnetic forces. And then we have on the other side, we have a collision operator. And this collision operator deals with short range forces. Yeah, so we distinguish between these two things to make our life easier. So I think time change is probably not that difficult. So we first of all deal with advection. So advection says, okay, there is a advection, this guy, yeah, no. This guy here. Okay, long, what do we mean with long range forces? Yeah, we mean the surface forces. Long range forces are forces that cannot easily be modeled by the collision. So collision means that two particles are in the same, more or less in the same space. Yeah, they reach each other, and when they touch each other, then there is a force acting on them. And when particles, so in principle, everything is particles. So if particles interact with each other while they are very, very far apart, then we would put this into this force field here. Yeah. So the classical thing would be the gravity. Okay. So gravity means there's one, so this is more or less a mean field. So there are many particles that make up the Earth, and they generate a gravity field, and this gravity field acts on this particle. So this is not so easily described as a collision. Yeah. So advection. Advection in principle is the following. So we have our particle. And this particle has a velocity, and this velocity we've defined as the small xi. And now, in a short time, this particle will move a distance lambda over time dt, so that you can define this velocity as the differential of the distance it's moving by the time that it's need to move. So very, very usual definition of the velocity. So what does this operator that we have up here, let's see whether we see this, what does it mean? So this xi dot nabla, this is a directional derivative. Yeah, so it distinguishes between the density of F, yeah, in space. So let's say we have this here would be x, and this would be f, and f is decreasing here. then if f is decreasing here, and this is f of say a positive velocity in x direction, okay, how to write this, then there will be a movement of density in the direction where the particle is flowing, when say density here is high and here is low, so then particles moving with xi will move density from the high from higher density to the lower density, but according to the velocity of this particle. Okay, we'll deal with this advection operator throughout the lecture much longer, for longer times. Maybe some text for later. So particles move in the they move in the direction of their velocity. And their velocity is xi. And okay, important. Okay, one important distinguishing is that we call xi this the microscopic velocity. So this is not the velocity of the gas itself, but it is the velocity of one particle. And the gas itself is made up of many, many particles. So we have a similar operator in the Navier-Stokes equation, but one thing is markedly different here. And this is a note that we have to take. The Boltzmann advection operator is linear. While the one in the Navier-Stokes equation is nonlinear. So, I mean, you compare for this, you have dtu, sorry, plus u dot now u. So this here is Navier-Stokes. And on the other side, you have dtf plus c. So it looks pretty similar, but the thing is that in this we have a nonlinear term because we have u times u. Okay, there's an operator in between. Here in in this, so what we have to understand, this is also f of xi, of course, but here this is a term because f is only multiplied by xi, but not by f again. So there is no nonlinearity in the Boltzmann equation on the left-hand side. All the nonlinearity in the Boltzmann equation comes on the right-hand side, which is the collision operator. And this is a big difference between the Navier-Stokes equation and the Boltzmann equation. So now coming to the most interesting part, which is the collision operator. So collision between particles. So first we have to start with an assumption. And this assumption is that we are only looking at binary collisions. So we assume that matter is so dilute that only two particles could ever meet at the same time. There will be never three particles at the same time. So only binary collisions, which means that two particles are involved and not more. Two particles involved, and okay, this is supposed to be a circle, but this is as much as I can draw a circle. So we have particles, let's say they come from the left-hand side and they collide, yeah? So then we call this here the pre-collision state. So this is the state before they collide. And in the pre-collision state, one particle has the velocity xi1 and the other has the velocity xi2. Then they collide, and while colliding, they exchange their velocity. So they change their velocity and exchange momentum. And then we have velocity xi1 dash and xi2 dash. Yeah? And this side I call the post-collision side. So this is in the, how to say, the laboratory frame of reference. So we look from outside on these two particles, and so these two particles may have any velocity, right? So, but we could also look at this in the center, in the center of mass. Center of mass, frame of reference. So center of mass, frame of reference. What does it mean? Center of mass, frame of reference means that the sum of the velocities must be zero, right? So the velocity, if this now is xi1, so then xi2 must go exactly in the opposite direction because we are in the center of mass of this collision. So, and then the outgoing, so in order to see this, now I'll switch the color. So the outgoing particles, oops, the outgoing particles will also go in exactly the opposite direction of each other, because the collision conserves momentum. Okay, so this is, here the particles simply get rotated in the center of mass. Frame of reference. Okay, we'll come to this in a minute. Just we have to write down everything that we know about the collision. So the collision has to obey conservation laws. Yeah, and the first conservation law is of course conservation of momentum. And because our particles cannot be distinguished, they both have the same mass. Yeah, so there could also be particles of different mass, but right now we look at particles of the same mass, and so momentum is just proportional to the velocity. So what we can say is that the velocity, if we sum up the velocity before the collision, yeah, this must be the same as the sum of the velocities after collision. So this is conservation of momentum, yeah. And if you are in the center of mass frame of reference, then this together is zero on the left-hand side and zero on the right-hand side. So there's another conservation law. This is the conservation of energy. Conservation of energy. So how does conservation of energy look like? Again, the mass of both particles are the same. So we only have to look at the square of velocity. Yeah. So if you like, you could also take the mass into consideration, and then you would have to add 1/2 m. Yeah. And now what is their energy? You get the square of the velocity by taking the scalar product of the velocity by itself. So this is for the particle, sorry, for the first particle and for the second particle. So this is the kinetic energy before the collision, and this is equal to the kinetic energy after the collision. Okay, so, and there's another, so these are the assumptions, yeah, conservation of momentum, conservation of energy, and then there is one assumption that is specific to the mesoscopic point of view, and this is called the molecular chaos assumption. Was actually Boltzmann's idea. Of course, in German, it's called Stoßzahlansatz. So, what does this mean? Very simple. Particles that are collide, they are uncorrelated. So what does it mean that they are uncorrelated? They are uncorrelated if they don't know anything of each other. So if you pick one particle and you pick the other particle that is colliding, then any information of particle 1 doesn't give you any information of particle 2. They are independent. Yeah? These are independent particles. So, and this is of course an assumption. Which is not really true, or not necessarily, but it's difficult to prove. So basically, it means that particles that collide with each other have never collided with each other before, or at least if they have, they have entirely forgotten about it. Okay, so this is an important assumption here. So now, now it is customary to simplify matters by putting by describing the collision actually in the center of mass frame of reference, and for this we introduce a parameter. So it's customary to parameterize the collision with a direction vector . This direction vector is called small sigma, and this only gives the direction, so its norm is 1. Yeah, it has length 1. So if we do this, we can write the velocity after the collision in terms of the center of mass and the sigma. So xi 1 after collision is xi 1 plus xi 2 half. So this is the, this here is the center of mass velocity. Center of mass velocity plus the difference in velocities, and here we just get the norm, the absolute value of this, times this parameter sigma, and then we also have the velocity of the other particle, which again is the center of mass velocity, minus, so it's going in the opposite direction, right? Exactly the opposite direction. Times sigma, okay? So, and this, with this parameterization, we come to the collision integral. Collision integral that we call omega. Some people call it Q or there are other names. So what is the collision integral? The collision integral is the change in time of F due to collision. Yeah, so this is also written like this. And collisions are local, so this is a local operator, so there's no integral over X, Y, Z. Yeah, but there is an integral over all directions. Yeah, so all directions. So this is the direction is sigma. So all directions is capital sigma. Yeah, all directions is this. And over all velocities of the second particle, so this is capital Xi, all velocities. Of the second particle, yeah. So, and then there is a collision kernel that only depends on the relative velocity between these particles, and it doesn't matter whether this is before or after collision, because the relative velocity doesn't change. I mean, doesn't change because of conservation of momentum. And the direction, so this is, these are the parameters allowed here. And then it is proportional to the probability, of course, that particle are meeting. So two particles meeting is the probability of the particle one in with the velocity xi one. So this here is after collision. But this is what's coming out. So now I'm running out of space here, unfortunately. Minus the state before collision. So two particles meeting. So the probability of two particles meeting is the product of the probability that any of them is there. And this is integrated over xi 2 and over phi. Okay? So after collision, before collision. And what this actually means, and how does this is called, this is the so-called gain term, and this is the loss term. Okay, so the loss term means that particle that come in this state, when they meet another part, so if a particle with velocity xi1 meets another particle with xi2, and there's a probability b that they are actually hitting each other, then the particle is scattered out of the velocity xi1, so it is lost. It is lost for, maybe I write this here a little bit nicer. So it is, no, this was not successful. Will it finally work? Okay, so this is for velocity xi1, right? The change in f fox velocity xi1. So if a particle with xi1 meets a particle with xi2 and it collides, then this is lost due to collision. But on the other hand, if the one particle exits this collision with velocity xi2 dash and it enters with velocity xi, so the other one enters with velocity xi1 dash, so then it is, then this is a gain term. So this goes into f xi1 and this goes out of f xi2, f xi1. So gain and loss. So So, then, okay, a few notes. Okay, I think I have to go to the next page. So the collision kernel which is not more specified here, is the probability of particles colliding if they come close to each other and have the velocity collide. So this is only a function of the relative velocity and phi. So this also makes it symmetric. And what I try to explain, gain particles are scattered into C1 and loss means particles are scattered out of C1. So, okay, 20 minutes. So, okay, I want to do two more things today. If it would just always have to press this twice. My God. So, okay, we will also want to talk about the conservation of the collision. Conservation laws. So I'm not going too much into detail on this today because we'll talk about this a lot later. So collision integral. This, of course, does not change mass and momentum. So the number of particles is conserved. This is relatively easy to see. And they also conserve energy. And this is expressed by the definition of moments. If we integrate over velocity 1 now, yeah, the collision operator, which is a distribution in velocity 1, of course, yeah, this is a function of V1, obviously, multiplied by a kernel function, which is also a function of V1, integrated over C1. And now we say that these things here is phi is an element of 1 C1 and C1 times C1. So this is the energy defining. So this is mass defining, velocity defining, and energy defining. So then this does not change. So this is zero. So, and these things, this, what I define here, this is called a moment. And we'll talk about moments a lot later in the lecture. The integral of a distribution. So distribution, this is now our distribution F. or for that matter, the collision operator, yeah, with a kernel phi, this is called a moment. So the collision integral has 5 conserved moments. And of course the velocity moments, so this has 3 components, yeah. So it has mass, 3 velocities, and 1 energy, and 1 energy moment. And these can also be expressed, so moments can be defined in different ways. And with moments, we can actually discover or recover the macroscopic variables that we also know from the continuous theory. So from a distribution F, these moments of a distribution F are the macroscopic known from continuum theory. So, for example, the density. Density rho is the integral over the velocity 1 f c 1. So in this case, yeah, we just integrate over this distribution function and then we get the density. The velocity u, so now this is the macroscopic velocity we also have in the Navier-Stokes equation. This we get by normalizing, so we divide should write this the same way every time. So my rho is probably not so beautiful, yeah, but this is the way I write a rho. So we normalize, divide by the first moment, the zero moment. So this is the first one here, this is zero moment, first moment. So first moment, and this is when we multiply with xc1. And then we also have something that's called the temperature. For this, we need the previous two moments. So we have to divide this by d rho. And so d is the number of dimensions, which is usually 3. F c 1 times C1 minus the macroscopic velocity, so which is the center of mass velocity, of course, of the distribution, dxc1. So, and D So this goes on the next page probably. So D, number of dimensions, which of course means D is usually 3, yeah. Okay, so we have a few more minutes. I try to do the eta theorem now, because I don't want to spend the next lecture again with the Boltzmann equation. So that's one more topic, the eta theorem. So the eta theorem, so this is sometimes called H theorem. Eta is the capital, so this what looks like an H is the capital of the Greek letter eta. Yeah, so this is why it's called eta theorem. Actually, it's not distinguishable from writing from a capital H. So what we are interested in is what happens if where is the collision going to? Yeah. We assume that there is a state when the collision does no longer change anything, and this state, this is called the equilibrium. So if collision does no longer change, so when the system is in equilibrium, then collision will produce the same number of F going in, so the loss term and the gain term will be identical, so the collision does not change anything anymore. And this state is said to be the equilibrium. So now Boltzmann asked the question, how can we describe and distinguish whether a system is in equilibrium? So first of all, let's say 1.1, equation 1.1, if we have this integral, and I now simplify this by not writing the bounds, b, f1, f2, yeah, so this is now here simplified versions, in equilibrium, so this is the gain term minus f1 equilibrium, f2 equilibrium, so everything is in equilibrium, and we integrate this, the sigma, so then this is 0, okay? In equilibrium, nothing changes anymore. Nothing. So this means, nothing means, so we can take now anything that gives us okay, let me finish this lecture before we get to books. I should not read it because I'm always coming out of where I was. So Boltzmann defined a functional H, eta of T, to help identifying equilibrium Now, we could derive this function, but this would take a lot of time and is actually not important, because the only thing that is important is actually that such a function can be defined. So he's defining a function that will not change in equilibrium. Okay, so this would be everything, but a function that only goes into a single direction over time. And this is the function h. And he has found that this function h can be defined as f on xi log f from xi integrated over xi and r. So r, so this integral, and this is pretty important, goes over all the velocities, were all microscopic, all microscopic velocities, and the complete space. So h, for the entire universe, h is a scalar. So, and now what Boltzmann does is he is taking the time derivative of this guy, dh of t by dt, and he is taking the time derivative into the integral f of xi log f of xi, and this is then integrated over xi and r, obviously. And okay, we apply the chain rule of this and get to the following. So dt of f of xi times, so now the logarithm, yeah, so we get actually f of xi by f of xi, which is of course 1, yeah, plus the logarithm of f of xi xi dr. So important to note here is that this here is the collision operator. So, and now there is this theorem stating, so the eta theorem, that dh by dt is smaller or equal to zero. And that equilibrium is, of course, when it's no longer changing at dh by dt. So why is this important? So it says that there is a functional that changes in time only in one direction. So this is something that doesn't happen in the molecular picture of the world. Yeah. So in the molecular picture, if you change the directions of all particles, everything goes backward. And here Boltzmann says, okay, there is something that is getting smaller when time progresses and is never getting larger. Yeah. And this can be used to determine the direction towards equilibrium. Okay, now, unfortunately, we don't have a lot of time left, but I don't want to have this cliffhanger here and want to finish this and ask the question, why is this? So first of all, I guess I have to give a name to the equation here. Okay, so this equation is the time derivative of eta, and now we said that we put 1.1, which is the collision operator, into 1.2, which is the equation that we just derived. And for this, we get to 1.3, which is dH by dt is the integral B F1 F2 after collision minus F1 F2 before collision, 1 plus log F1. And all of this is now integrated over the entire space, because from the collision operator, we have the integral over xi2. From the definition of h, we have the integral over xi1. And we have still from the collision operator and the integral over sigma, and from the definition of eta, we have the integral over r. Now, important to know is that because we are integrating over both of them, f1 and f2 are interchangeable. Yeah, the equation is the same for both of them. So whether particle 1 collides with particle 2 or particle 2 collides with particle 1 doesn't matter. So we can write an equation 1.4, and this will be the same, 1, 2 minus F1, 2, with this one single difference, because the only thing that defined the particle was F, was this F1 here. Yeah. So now we can write this for particle 2 due to symmetry between these particles. This is also true. And what we can do next is we can simply add up 1.3 plus 1.4, which gives us 1.5, which is 2 times the left-hand side of this equation. And here we get B F1, so this was the same thing for both of them, minus F1 F2. So the difference here was that we have, okay, we have a 2 here plus the logarithm, and the sum of logarithms is, of course, the logarithm of the product. Yeah, so we can write this together here, and this is an integral over xi 1. Sigma and dr. Okay? So this comes from symmetry. Then there is an additional symmetry, namely that the collision goes the same way in one direction and the other direction. Yeah? So this is very interesting, because we are currently trying to prove that something goes that something, this h, changes in time in a specific direction. But in order to prove this, we assume that the collision can go in reverse. So it can go forward and backward the same. So this means we can exchange F1 after collision with F1, F2 after collision with F1, F2 before collision. which gives us the equation 1.6. So again, we have 2 d eta by dt is equal to the integral b f1 f2. Now we exchange the direction. Yeah, so I exchanged this. So the gain and the loss term, the gain and the loss term, which changes the sign of the integral. And here we have 2 plus now the logarithm of f1, f2. And I just noticed that I'm running over time. I'm sorry, but this is something that we have to finish now. dx1, dx2, and dr. So, and now the last step that we do is we add 1.5 plus 1.6 together, and then we have, of course, 4 times the time derivative, but I put this on the other side. Dt, so I put this is 1/4, yeah, and now I return to the direction of the loss term from equation 1.5 minus f1 f2. Now the sign in 1.6 was different, yeah, so notice we have here a 2 and we have a 2 in the other equation, but with the different sign. This will cancel out. So what we are left with is the logarithm of f1 f2 minus logarithm of f1 f2, and yeah, all the integration things. 1 c2 sigma and dr, and this in fact is smaller than 0. So I'm almost 5 minutes over time, but let me finish this, because otherwise I so why is this smaller than 1? Remember that the logarithm is monotonic. Yeah, and what we have now here is, you know, running over time when the software doesn't work. Okay, I do it without this. So the logarithm is monotonic, and up here we have f1 dash f2 dash minus f1 f2, and here we have log f1 f2 minus log f1 f2 dash. Yeah. So what does it mean? If now I'm also running out of space. Great. Great. So it is monotonic. It is monotonic, and this means that if we have f1, f2, if this is smaller than f1 dash f2 dash, then this implies that log f1 f2 is also smaller than log f1 dash f2 dash, right? So, and now because, so this means that if this here is smaller 0, then the other one is larger 0, because there is a sign difference in between. And this proves that indeed this time derivative goes always in the same direction. And with this, we have shown that eta provides a direction of time and the system approaches the equilibrium, so it goes always closer to equilibrium, and the equilibrium is reached when we have dH by dt. So if this does no longer change, then we are at equilibrium. And okay, the very last thing, h is also the scaled negative entropy. Okay, I'm running 7 minutes over time. Yeah, I suggest that because unfortunately I have a master defense in 7 minutes, that further discussions and how we are processing, we continue in the next lecture. If you have any questions also regarding any books, please write them in the messenger, and I will ask later in the messenger. So unfortunately, I have no time, and you probably also have no time for further discussions. I'm sorry for overtiming. And time is the thing that we don't have. Therefore, I wish you a nice weekend now, and see you hopefully on next Friday. Okay? Goodbye.